Hello everyone. In this video, we will discuss about shortest job first scheduling. So this is another scheduling algorithm, but here how we are scheduling the process, the incoming process may have different burst time. So based on the burst time, whatever it has and which process is said to be the shortest burst time, so only that process will be scheduled initially. So that is what the concept of this shortest job first scheduling algorithm. So let us see with an example. It is also termed as shortest next CPU burst algorithm. Okay, so here if you look at this example, we have some set of process. There are actually four process, and here also we don't have any different arrival time, so all the process which arrives at the same time, that is zero. And the next burst time has been given here. For the first process it is 6, for the second process it is 8, third process it is 7, and fourth process it is 3. How to find out all these time, completion time, turnaround time and waiting time? Before that, we need to draw this Gantt chart. How to draw the Gantt chart? So first, we have to check it. So though it has been arrived at the same time, right? So we have to check it, which has the shortest burst time. Okay. So among the P1, P2, P3, P4, which is the shortest one? P4 is the shortest one. So we need to schedule this P4 process initially. So at time 0, we have scheduled this P4 process. So how long it will be executed? It will be executed only for 3 units of time. So it will be completed at time 3. And the next process that to be scheduled, which is nothing but P1. So after this 3, so this is the next shortest burst time. So we are scheduling P1. And its burst time is 6, so it will be completed at 9. And the next process to be scheduled, which is nothing but P3, because it is the next shortest burst time. So we are just scheduling it, and its burst time is 7, so it will be completed at 16. Finally, we are scheduling this P2 process and it will be completed at 24. So these are all nothing but the completion time what we are getting for each and every process. So we are just writing all those things by referring this Gantt chart easily, right? And the next one, turnaround time. So though we don't have the different arrival time, so same time whatever we got as a completion time will be given for this turnaround time, right? And the next one is waiting time. So we can calculate easily by subtracting turnaround time by the burst time. 9 minus 6, that is 3. 24 minus 8, that is 16. 16 minus 7, that is 9. 3 minus 3, 0. So why we are getting this as a waiting time 0? Because we have scheduled this P4 initially. So at what time it enters into the system, at the same time we have scheduled this process. So its completion, waiting time is 0. And these are all the other waiting time for the corresponding process. Now if you want to calculate the average waiting time, so you are just getting 7 milliseconds. It is 7 milliseconds. So based on the shortest job for scheduling, we are getting its value, that is average waiting time value is 7 milliseconds. So for the same problem, if you follow this first come first serve, what will happen? So it is average waiting time is 10.25 milliseconds. So you are getting it as 10.25 because so you have to follow in the same order that it enters into the system. You should not change the order, right? So first you have to schedule P1, then P2, then P3, then P4, like that you have to schedule. For the first process, P1, its waiting time will be 0 because at time enters we are at the same time we are scheduling it. But for the second process, how long it has to wait? It has to wait for 6 milliseconds because only after the completion of P1, P2 may enter, right? So then third process, its waiting time will be the addition of these two, that is 14, because only after the completion of these two process it can schedule. And for the fourth process, which is nothing but 14 plus 7, that is 21. So these are all the corresponding waiting time of these process. And if you find out the average waiting time, so you are just getting it as 10.25 milliseconds, which is more than the shortest job first, right? For the same problem, if you go with these two kinds of scheduling, so you are just getting this average waiting time. So here we are getting the minimal average waiting time. So it could be the optimal one than the first come first serve. Shortest job first will be the optimal one than optimal to use. It is more efficient than first come first serve. It is also this problem what we have solved using the shortest job first scheduling, but it works under non-preemptive. Okay. First serve also works under non-preemptive, but here the shortest job first will not only work under non-preemptive, we may also one more choice that it may work under preemptive also. So we will discuss what is the preemptive type of shortest job first scheduling. Okay, so what are all the disadvantages of this shortest job first scheduling? If you look at this, as the name suggests, we should know in advance what are all the process, their corresponding burst time. We should know it in advance, but it is highly difficult to know what could be the process burst time, right? Knowing the length of the CPU burst time, which is much more difficult to find out what could be the burst time. So we can require that in case of batch environment, user submitting their job, so he can also provide what could be the process time limit. So we can get this particular information from the user, but suppose in some cases if it is a wrong value, then we have to suffer. We cannot provide the optimal final output, isn't it? So that could be the disadvantage of the shortest job first. So it might be used in long-term scheduling, but it is not more efficient to use in short-term scheduling. So what is long-term scheduling? So if you all want to schedule any of the process from secondary to main memory, that is what long-term scheduling or job scheduling. But it will not work well if you go and use with shortest job first schedule. I mean, what is it? Short-term scheduling or CPU scheduling. Okay. So how to know this burst time? So we can get the burst time by using some exponential average time. So which means the already process whatever we have depends upon the same type of process. Whatever the process already that we were executed, so depends upon their completion time, we can predict the incoming process burst time also. So we have some methodologies to use to find out the what is the burst time of the incoming process. So we will discuss all those things. Okay. Thank you.